All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and get started. This is the February 21st meeting of the Village of Oxford Planning Commission, our regularly scheduled meeting for this evening. And I'm glad to see you all here, and I thank you very much for taking time out of your evenings to attend. To begin the meeting, I'd like to ask you all to please join me in paying respects to our flags by saying Pledge Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mr. Secretary, if you'd be kind enough to conduct a roll call of the commissioners present, please.
Name, Rose Bama.
Here.
Jack Curtis.
Present.
Gary Deeg, excused. Gary Douglas.
Here.
Maureen Helmuth.
Here.
Adam Johnson.
Here.
Make a motion to excuse Gary Deeg for the meeting.
A second for that motion, please.
Second.
I have a motion to excuse Commissioner Deeg from tonight's meeting, offered by Maureen Helmuth, Commissioner Helmuth. And I have a second from Commissioner Curtis. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, say nay. All right, that motion carries. Gary Deeg's absence is excused tonight. He said he was going to be out on the east side and probably would not be able to get back in time. Also, at this time, I would like to entertain a motion to approve this evening's agenda, which has been submitted to us in our packets.
I'll make a motion to approve the Village of Oxford Planning Commission regular meeting for Tuesday, February 21st, 2017.
Second.
All right. Mr. Secretary, I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda offered by Commissioner Curtis and seconded by Commissioner Bama. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. All right, that motion carries. Tonight's agenda is approved. Next on the agenda, which is now approved, I would like to accept a motion for the approval of the minutes of the regular meeting from February 7th of this month, just recently.
I'd like to make a motion to set the minutes aside until the next regular meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? Commissioner Helmuth, you can discuss that now, or do you want to do it later?
They're incomplete. There were just sections that I don't think she got to doing the minutes. There's nothing about the zoning board of appointment, the appeals appointment.
Okay.
So.
All right. I have a motion on the table to suspend the approval of the minutes from the previous meeting. That motion was offered by Commissioner Helmuth and seconded by Adam. Did you say?
No.
Was that Rose?
Rose.
All right. Rose seconded by Commissioner Bama. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. All right, that motion to suspend that approval until next meeting. That motion will carry as well. All right, item number 6 on the agenda is receiving and filing any correspondence.
There was none.
There was none for this meeting. I did not see any in my package, so we'll skip over that step. Item number 7 is a public hearing in regards to rezoning of 98 Glaspie, the rear parcel, from R3 to R1. It is now approximately 7:03, and I would accept a motion to go into public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Helmuth and seconded by Commissioner Curtis. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. All right, we are now in a public hearing. This issue is in regards, as I said, to a rezoning of 98 Glaspie rear parcel from R3 to R1. This meeting is now open to any public comment. If you have comments, I would like you to please step to the podium. We're welcome to hear your comments. If you'll address those comments to me, I would appreciate it. And I'm more than happy to hear what you have to say. If any of you are interested, please. If you'd step forward and please state your name for the record, and then let's hear what you have to say.
Sure. Kelly Arkles, 491 Thornhill Trail.
Say it again, please.
Kelly Arkles, 491 Thornhill Trail.
Welcome, Kelly.
Thank you. I have just one question and then a comment. The question would be, moving it from R3 to R1, how many more houses would that entail?
Mr. Corey, would you be kind enough to address that?
Well, we won't know exactly for sure until a site plan is laid out, approximately 2.
Okay, and then for a total on both parcels?
16.
Okay, great, thank you. And then my other comment would be that I want to thank somebody, I'm not sure whom. Last year when we were dealing with another proposal, it was, and Chris helped me out here, it went with only the people who were 300 feet away from the property were notified. And I want to thank somebody, everybody, for notifying us on Thornhill Trail. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. I appreciate your comments. They're very welcome here. Anyone else would like to make a comment? You're more than welcome. The floor is yours. Please. And again, if you'd be kind enough to state your name for the record so that we can record that.
Sure. Hi, I'm Mark Miner. I live on 50 Pearl Street.
Thank you, Mark.
Hi. And I have, I guess, some questions exactly, and maybe it's out there already, but I don't know the answers. How many more homes are being decided, and what's the increase in population expected on that road?
Well, Mark, that's not exactly clear right now. All we're doing is tonight is considering an approval to rezone the property. No site plan has been offered yet by the developer, and so those details are not set yet. And that will be taken care of later when a site plan is created and submitted back to us for our consideration. Chris, please, if you want to amend that.
We have an estimate. And again, this may not be the final number, but it's going to be approximate. That would be 16 homes.
16 homes.
16 homes.
Okay, so this is in place of that industry back there, that shop, or whatever that thing
Spearing
is?
Spearing tool.
Okay, so they would tear that down and then the homes would come up after that?
That's my understanding.
Okay. So I'm, and again, I don't know if this is fact or not, but I've heard that our drainage on Pearl Street goes down to that retention pond by the ball field. Is that correct?
Chris, do you have any information about the drainage in that location?
I'm not sure. We'd have to ask the Joe Mano, village engineer.
Storm drainage. You're talking about Pearl Street?
Yes.
The outfall, it goes down, Pearl goes down to Inslee, which goes to Broadway, which ends up going into the wetlands behind the pond.
Wetlands behind the pond? Okay.
Well, it's to the south of the pond.
So the concern would be this, is if these homes came in there, would they be filling up the pond with their drainage that we would not be able to drain our street properly?
That would not be a factor. They would be needing to address their drainage when they submit their site plan.
Exactly. Once the site plan is submitted by the developer, all of that will be addressed. And certainly, if you have a concern about that, I would strongly encourage you to come to any meetings where we're discussing the site plan and make sure that your concerns about that are heard and addressed, because certainly the developers are going to take care of what the community wants and needs. And so nobody will turn a deaf ear to that concern.
Okay. Thank you. And the next question I have is it about the homes themselves and Scripters Park. Are they going to put homes around that lake there?
Chris, it's my understanding that this property basically overlooks a portion of the Scripter Lake. Is that correct?
And it does, although this property does not border the water.
That's correct.
There is public property between this property and the water, and there will continue to be public property from this part of the water, between this and the water. Technically, it's part of the park. So there will not be any waterfront homes in terms of people having land that goes all the way to the water. I've also had some preliminary discussions with the developer about how the homes will relate to the park, because there will be homes immediately adjacent to it.
Right, which to me, from a park perspective, is an eyesore. But we already do have homes on the other side already. I understand that. We have beautiful trees on the right-hand side. And right now we have a beautiful park on the left-hand side. So my question was, I'm okay with getting rid of a giant factory that is no longer there. That's a good thing for the city. But having homes come up and encroach on the park, I think is an eyesore on the left-hand side of the park. I mean, you can't help what's happening on the opposite side. They're there and they're not going to move. But if there could be a way to protect the aesthetics on that side with trees or whatever, or something that would say, you know, this is still a park over here for the members of the village,
mm-hmm.
that would be better than urban sprawl.
Sure, and I understand that, Mark. And once again, I want to remind you that tonight we're only considering the rezoning of this property.
Yeah.
And so once we move to the phase where a developer is bringing in a site plan to us, that's the time when I really encourage you to involve yourself and come and talk to the developer and have your input put into what the local residents are desiring for that property. that's how we work this.
All right, thank you.
But I do appreciate your comments, and I thank you very much for taking the time to come.
Thank you.
All right, we're still in public session, or public hearing. Anybody else would like to make a comment? I'm more than happy to hear them. Good, thank you. Good evening. If you'd be kind enough, state your name slowly so we can hear it for the record, and then we're...
Richard Schroeder.
Thank you, Mr. Schroeder.
72 Pearl.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Schroeder.
The end of the street. And I just want some clarification on the rezoning. Mm-hmm. Now, from what I saw on the mailings, it looked like there were two plots of land. One already had the proper zoning, and this is merely upgrading what I considered the eastern or the rear part of the property to the same zoning as the front. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So it would be a, they would all be the same. You wouldn't have some houses with larger plots, some houses with smaller.
That would be the expectation.
And I couldn't make clear from the overhead photograph, but I'm a big Scripter Trail hiker, mm-hmm. which I'm a little discouraged because we've had some intrusion from fallen trees mm-hmm. since last fall. But where would that rezoned property end? Would Scripter Trail still have integrity?
Okay.
Oh, color.
Yeah. We're a first-class organization, Richard.
Sometimes.
Okay. So it looks like the trail is still going to maintain the same course.
Yes.
And what type of gradient would you assume? Is it basically going to be the gradient from 20 or from Gillespie to the back of the property plot? Or?
I don't anticipate that would change, but again, a site plan has not been created right. for this, so I don't have a confirmation
of that.
It's kind
of tight there in the rezoned area. I was just wondering, it looks like they would probably, and it's fairly level right now. In other words, there's a slope down to the mm-hmm. trail and to the mm-hmm. lake access. So thank you for your answers on that.
I'm welcome to take them.
That's okay.
I would say I do the trail quite often, so I'm familiar with it.
Good. Good. Thank you very much. Appreciate your coming. All right, we're still in public hearing. Anybody else would like to make a comment? I'm more than happy to hear them. Please.
Another question.
Again, state your name, please.
Oh, Kelly Arkles.
Thank
Sorry.
You, Kelly.
When approximately do we think the site plans are going to be ready to review?
I haven't heard anything myself, Kelly. I don't know that the... I can't speak to that myself.
Okay, thank you.
Chris, have you heard anything?
All we have at this point is a purchase agreement and a due diligence process, which ends at the end of March. Is that correct? And so this rezoning, the question of whether this rezoning will be granted is part of the due diligence, and I'm sure they're doing some others, and it won't be until after that anything is moved forward.
Okay, thank you.
Good, thank you, Kelly. All right, still public hearing. Any other comments? I'm happy to hear them. All right, just for the record, I want you all to know, it will always be the intent of this commission while I'm the chair, that we take public comment very, very seriously. And we certainly welcome public attendance at these meetings. We welcome to hear your comments. We listen very carefully to them, and we take them into consideration. So please, as this process develops, if you have an interest in this or you have concerns, please pay attention to the process and come as you are able to. We typically meet twice a month, and we love to have people here. It's great to see you all here tonight. Thank you very much. All right, are there any other comments or public input to the hearing? Because if not, I'm going to close out of public hearing, and we'll move on with the rest of our meeting. All right, I'll accept a motion to close public hearing.
So moved.
I have a motion from Commissioner Helmuth, a second.
I moved.
Rose, okay. Mr. Secretary, I have a motion from Commissioner Helmuth and a second from Commissioner Bema that we end.
Opposite.
It's all good.
Bema made the motion.
I beg your pardon. Helmuth. Mr. Secretary?
Seconded.
We have a motion from Commissioner Bema and a second from Commissioner Helmuth. You guys spoke so fast, I couldn't even tell you guys apart. All right, all those in favor of ending public hearing?
7:13.
Signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. All right, we will exit public hearing. All right, item number 8 on the agenda is to address old business. I see that we have no items listed under old business, so I'm going to skip over that and go right to item 9, which is new business. Section A is rezoning of 98 Gillespie rear parcel from R3 to R1. Now, Mr. Corey, I'm assuming that you have some comments that you would like to address here. I want to first off thank you very much for a very thorough study that you put together for this. It was very complete, and I appreciated all your comments. So you do a very professional job for us, and I want you to know how much I appreciate it.
Appreciate the kind words, Mr. Chair. I think we've talked a little bit about the background, what the purpose of this is. It would be from an R3 zoning district to an R1. Those are both single-family categories. R3 requires larger lots than R1 does, which is why one of the reasons why our applicant is requesting. I suppose the other one is to make sure that the lots are consistent size across the development and that there's no impediment to the design of the development in the form of an imaginary man-made line in the middle of the parcel which has to become parcel lines for zoning reasons. So for those reasons, the request is to go from R3 to R1. And there's a few criteria the Planning Commission should take into account when looking at a rezoning. First one is, what does the master plan say? Well, the master plan is actually very specific about this because this was one of the parcels looked at during the Near East Side redevelopment plan process last year. The master plan says unequivocally, this plan would support a rezoning to make the entire site one consistent single-family zoning category, R1, R2, or R3. So the master plan is very much in favor. The second thing to take a look at is what's going on around the site. We had some of the public commented on that. Obviously, to the north, we have the park space. Single-family homes are compatible with park space, obviously, although as we had some people mention, the actual design will want to make sure the park is respected and the homes have privacy. But as far as the rezoning goes, that's definitely compatible. To the west, you have other single-family homes, also compatible. To the east, you have a little bit of park space, including the trail, and then the lake. That's as well compatible, but again, is something has to be addressed during the design phase in terms of how the homes address that park space and the lake. To the south, you have the DPW complex, which is not really compatible, but can be made compatible, hopefully by the design of the developers. In terms of screening and buffering, so that people whose backyards go up against the DPW facility are not really negatively impacted there. So I don't see that as an impediment to granting this rezoning. Let's see, what else do we have? Honestly, that covers it, because the other things that are on the rezoning checklist are very simple, like, are the uses compatible with in the two districts that are being proposed or being removed or proposed, and in that case they're the same, so it's almost like a doesn't apply type thing. So given that, I am recommending this be recommended for the council for approval. Thank you.
Mr. Village Manager, I have a question for you, sir.
Certainly.
Just to the south of this double lot is our DPW
and water site. Treatment plant.
And water treatment plant. The nature of this facility is such that it's a noise-producing facility, or no?
Only when they're out plowing snow.
Understand that.
So, when the generator goes on, but that's during the day.
Pardon me, I'm sorry.
Pardon?
I'm just coughing. I'm just listening to you. Is this an odor-producing facility?
No.
Okay, so water treatment, there's no odor associated with any of that. All right, good. Mr. Corey, in a development like this, whose responsibility would be to screen DPW yard from the...
That's an interesting question. Ordinarily, it's the non-residential use. However, the DPW yard was there first, and I've relayed to our developers, and I think they understand that in order to make those homes saleable, they're going to have to make sure that that's well screened.
And right now, what are the requirements from the village in terms of appropriate screening?
There are a few options, and they are basically some combination of landscaping and fencing.
I can see on the photograph that it appears on the eastern edge of the boundary of that second property that there is a line of trees that currently exists. Have you walked this property?
Yeah. Are you talking about the line of trees on the east end of the property?
Yes.
Or on the south?
Yes, on the east.
Yes, those trees are actually, Zarkles could probably tell you about those trees, because I know that they're valued by the people on the other side of the lake for the views.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what our applicants would be considered doing with those trees.
Mm-hmm. Are they tall enough to screen?
They're very tall.
They look much nicer in this picture than they are in real life.
Well, I'm trying to visualize this. It's been quite a long time since I've been there.
They look nicer from a distance than they do up close.
Okay.
Because they're very tall trees, but they're not in great shape.
I see. Okay. All right, commissioners, do you have any other comments about this?
Should I accept any other comments from the public? Is it necessary to discuss this right now?
No, we can discuss it.
Okay. Commissioner Helmuth?
I've discussed this property way more than I need to. I'm good.
Okay. Commissioner Bama?
The site plan will start showing where the screening will go. Is that not correct?
I would expect that that would be, if it was going to be included, it would likely be included in the site plan.
Then nothing at this time.
I think just, you know, the only concern, I guess, and this is just me talking, I would want to make sure that the village does not get stuck with the bill for creating a screen there because it's shielding our facility. That's why I asked whose responsibility is it to create a screen for the development. And I'm not sure if we have a rule for that. Do we have a rule that...
It's highly... we have very clear rules on screening between residential and non-residential. Ordinarily, it's a responsibility of the non-residential. In this case, the residential is the new thing. And it would be my opinion that it'd be a responsibility of the residential to create the screen. And I also think it would be in their best interest.
Sure.
Because they're not going to sell a lot for someone to build a house, and there's no screening between them and DPW.
Mm-hmm. Chuck, did you have a question? You want to step up to the podium? State your name, please, for the record.
This is Chuck Snyder. My suggestion to you would be to have a very thorough survey of the east property line, because when I surveyed that myself, we just did a corner survey, but that line of trees I think is on the park property, not this R3 property. So if that is the case, then the developer can't really touch those trees. But I think you need to do that like every 10 or 20 feet to make sure. But I think it's on the park side.
Okay, thank you.
I have no comments.
All right. Adam?
No comments.
Commissioner Adam?
All right.
I have no comments other than the fact that, with all due respect, Mr. Schneider, I'm not sure that the survey would necessarily have any bearing upon the request to have the property rezoned.
Do you have to tell the development?
Sure, I understand that.
It really pertains to the question of screening.
Yes, and I understand that. My expectation, again, not being a professional developer or land use administrator, other than being the chair of a planning commission, that I would expect a survey is probably a standard part of that. In getting a site plan prepared, they want to make sure exactly where the boundaries are.
Based on the findings identified in the McKenna and Associates letter dated February 13, 2017, I make a motion to recommend to the Oxford Village Council the rezone of parcel 04-26-101-013 from R3 single family residential to R1 single family residential. End of motion.
Second.
All right, Mr. Secretary, I have a motion tendered by Commissioner Curtis and seconded by Commissioner Bama. Is there any other further discussion on this motion? Commissioners? I have a motion on the table. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Any opposed say nay. All right, that motion carries. We will tender a suggestion. We will forward our recommendation to the Village Council that this rezoning effort to be approved. I'm sorry, everyone, I just got dry all of a sudden. All right, item B under new business is a proposed zoning ordinance and zoning map. Mr. Corey, I believe this is a continuation of the discussion we held at our previous meeting, is that correct?
That is correct.
Other than the letter you have submitted to us with some clarifications on some of the questions that came about in that meeting, do you have anything else to offer?
No, just to discuss, discuss those.
Pardon me, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was planning to discuss those items in some detail with the commission and hopefully come to some consensus.
Please go right ahead, then.
Okay. I'll take them one at a time based on the memo. The first one was multifamily unit sizes and densities compared to what our current and proposed zoning standards are. And Mr. Young was kind enough to do some research on the existing multifamily buildings and complexes in the village, compare them to what we've got
Thank you, bless
as far as current
your heart.
Zoning, and as far as the Economic Development Subcommittee's recommended changes. I think one takeaway I had from this is that our minimum unit size could be smaller and still be consistent with what's in the village. And as far as the density goes, it could be a little higher, but I think we're close to on track, especially with the form-based code idea being that your density limit is what you can fit within the form-based code parameters, especially because if you look at the unit or the buildings that are more dense, quote unquote, on a unit per acre basis, than the 15 that's current units per acre currently proposed, those are closer to the core of the village and they're smaller lots with just a building. And then when you do units per acre, sure, it comes out a lot, but it's really just a building with a limited number of apartments. That's a little different than taking that number of units per acre over a 10-acre site or something like that. Not that we have too many of those. So that was my takeaway, and I'd be interested to hear what the commission's takeaway from that data was.
Commissioners?
I just want to say, I knew my first apartment wasn't 1,300 square feet.
No. Most sure first apartments are not.
It was at 375.
1,300 is larger than my home, so.
Yeah.
I don't think 1,300 is, that was one of the first things the Economic Development Subcommittee tackled, because 1,300 is problematic in a number of ways. Their recommendation was 800. I know Mr. Schneider is advocating for less than that. And it does appear that the data backs him up a little bit in terms of what we've already got being more in the 500, 400 range. Not that we want brand new apartments to be as small as some of our existing, but the question is, what does the commission think?
Mr. Corey, can you envision that decreasing our minimum unit size would create a more attractive environment for building new apartment blocks?
It would make things more attractive for developers. It would also make the apartments themselves more affordable to mm-hmm. renters. I'm not a developer. My understanding is that the developers have to base their rent based on how much they spent per square foot to build the place. And that number of square, if you've got X number of square feet, means more to build, means more rent. But again, the flip side to that, I suppose, is that we don't want a proliferation of extremely inexpensive units.
Mm-hmm.
So while 1,300 was way too much, because it's impossible to build anything at that size affordably, 800 is what we've got. And the question is, are you comfortable with that or do you want to go lower?
Okay. Mr. Village Manager, pardon me for talking with cough drop in my mouth. Thank you very much, Ms. Schneider. When you collected this data, did you actually go to the apartments and talk to a management there and acquire that information, or did you pick this information up offline or something like that?
The one I did call, the largest one, Village Manor, the others, I took the assessor records and information and the square footage number of units.
Do we have an impression of what the demand for affordable housing is here in this village?
Well, there's
from a rental standpoint, like when, you know, if you know, I'm trying to think forward here. If we create an environment where there's more, perhaps it's more advantageous for the developer to come in and build a new block of apartments, do we have a demand for that right now? Are people clamoring to find rental space in the village? Or is there a dearth of apartments? And I guess I'm kind of wondering about what the occupancy rate is at some of these apartments. And if they're 50% empty, that doesn't serve anybody at all. But if they're 100% full and there's a great demand for it, it seems to me that...
No, I'd say based on visual observance of for rent spaces, there are seldom many out there. There are right now. There's some. I've been looking around because people are looking for a place to live. And again, the quality is the price.
Mm.
Sure. Speaks to Mr. Corey's point.
And I'm looking in the downtown area here, so there are some available, but some of them are pricey. And there's certainly not a vacancy issue that I'm aware of.
Okay.
I didn't ask Village Man. I know she did say that the smaller ones, there's always a waiting list. There's no problem running the smaller ones. And they have quite a few, 400, 500, 600 units. They have several out there.
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead, Mr. Curtis.
A few years ago, Joe, we did a study, and you remember it was 98% occupancy rates, and they were driving that way. I don't want to make a keyhole to fit the key here. And an example of that would be, let's just say, if it cost you $100 a square foot to build a place, to break even on a 1,300 square foot apartment, that would be $1,300 a month. No room for profit. If it were 375 square feet, you know, there's room for profit there, but are you building a unit that's compatible to what you're trying to develop in your downtown area? You still want to have profitability for developers, but you got to have common sense development. And I would really recommend sitting down with a couple of core developers, these apartment people, and saying, you know, what is the highest demand apartment? Because I know right now Abbey Ridge apartments are very pricey and they're very big, but they're not in a downtown village development area. Number one, maintaining profitability for the developer. Number two, maintaining occupancy rates. You don't want to price yourself out of the market by saying 800 square feet. That automatically tells me if it were 100 square foot to build, you're going to be at $1,000 a month to make some money. So what is the perfect fit? We have some EDSC recommendations here at 800 square feet. I don't know as if that's the right number. I don't believe it is.
Yeah, I was wondering where that number came from.
That's a big apartment to try to rent out for $1,000 a month.
It's got down to 600.
Yeah, it came back up during discussions. 600 is sort of it.
I'm just throwing that out there for conversation.
You also have the option of, you don't have to have a regulation on this in your zoning ordinance at all. Conceivably, you could just let the market speak.
That
can be dangerous. You know, you don't want to create slums. But if we want to say we don't want any sort of regulation on that in our zoning ordinance, and we'll take them as they come, that is an option.
I don't think that the size creates the slum. I think the quality of the building creates that. Size is driven by what people can afford and what developers can afford to build and demand a price for. By requiring a square foot minimum, I think we have to be cautious on that. You will definitely regulate growth because people won't want to build and try to capitalize on profit. My thoughts.
Do we want to send this issue back to the Economic Development Committee? Commissioner Hellman?
I just want to say I have 3 young people that I'm kicking out of my house at the end of March, and they better find an apartment. And I'm going to tell you what, they can't afford a 1,300 square foot apartment.
I think everyone's in agreement on that.
And I think if you take a lower number and you make it an average, say 550, now you can have one that's 450 and one that's 650, and let the developer work it out. You know, if you want to have a one bedroom, fine, have a one bedroom, but then you're going to need a 3-bed, you know, whatever it is. And let the developer figure it out. But they better do it fast, because I got 3 kids that need apartments in a month and a half. Somebody build something.
I think that's a really interesting idea.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of a minimum unit size, minimum average unit size for the entire
property. Or range.
Yeah.
Range, yeah.
If you want to have an efficiency, fine, but you got to catch it up on the other end.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd like to make it simple, you know, not like a crazy, well, if you have this many efficiencies, you must have this many. It's like, it should, if it's something like that, I think it should just be average out the size of your units, or median size, maybe. If we think that's, if we want to avoid someone building a gigantic penthouse and then a bunch of dorm rooms and saying, well, average, But yeah, basically saying you could build smaller than this, but you have to offset it on the top end. Would you like me to craft something on that?
I was going to say, Mr. Curry, if you'd be kind enough to take this back to the Economic Development Subcommittee and have them reevaluate their recommendation for this and come up with something I think is more in line with what the commission's considering, I think that would probably be
the only concern about that is the Economic Development Subcommittee isn't going to meet again until at least the end of March, and it's in a little bit of flux because of the absence of a DDA director.
I see.
So it's a little hard to take it back to them and then come back to you in a timely fashion.
Technically, from this table, this board, the planning commission, this will go to the full council.
That's correct.
It will not go back to the subcommittee because they're just recommending.
I see.
So the normal process is the planning commission makes recommendations, planning.
Correct.
To go to council.
Correct.
Certainly run it by them, of course, the committee.
So you want this commission to state whether they want an ordinance stating the qualified square foot of an apartment?
Well, yeah. I mean, do you want, do you want a minimum unit size in the zoning ordinance? Two, how would you like to, do you have a number that you think that we can coalesce around? Or three, would you rather have it be some sort of formula so you can have small units and big units as long as there's a mix?
Commissioner Howland?
Pete, is there something in the fire code about residential unit sizes? No? But there's bedroom sizes in one in the building code, possibly?
Building code, maybe, but again, it's pretty minimal. Because I mean, the 375 foot.
That's no walls, it's an efficiency.
They're
wonderful.
Yeah.
Mr. Steiner, you had a question. Or comment?
Question, I have a comment, though.
Thank you.
You're flirting with the right idea. What's our minimum size of a house?
It's 900. Well, it depends on the zoning district. R3 is like 1,200. Somehow it is less than an apartment,
so
which is
wacky. So let's think about this.
Yeah.
Mr. and Mrs. Smith and their three kids and dog are going to move into a 1,000 square foot house. But Joe, the college student, he's going to move into an 800 square foot apartment.
Mm-hmm.
200 feet is a parking space. That's the difference in size, 10 by 20. So a family is in a house, one parking space bigger than what Joe is in. That's not, doesn't jive. The reality is, if it costs you $100 a square foot of construction cost and $50 a foot of site costs, times 800 square feet is $120,000 to build the unit. At 10% of cost, 5% for a mortgage and 5% in debt reduction, that's $1,000 a month. To that, we have to add taxes, insurance, utilities, maintenance. Not going to happen. You know, you have to get these rents down to $600-700 a month tops. I'm a victim to somebody right now. They pay $560 a month and they can't make that. And I pay the utilities. So Marina's kind of got the right idea. You should allow the developer to have some flexibility. You know, you don't want, I mean, to me, the range should be 400 to 800. So a one-bedroom efficiency is 400, a one-bedroom non-efficiency might be 600, and then a two-bedroom unit is 800. But I'm not building a lot of 800-square-foot units because the people aren't going to be able to afford them. And then, of course, we want landscaping, and we want green space, and we want this, and we want that. And do we want carports or no carports? So the reality is, I think the 550 average is too high. I think you want 4, 6, and 8. Efficiency, one bedroom, two bedroom. And let the developer, based on, you know, this is like when I worked for Ford. For years, the executives of the Ford Motor Company told the consumer what they were going to build. That didn't work out real good. It works a lot better when the consumer tells the car manufacturer, or in this case, the developer, what they want. it's a lot better sale. It's easier to sell somebody what they want as opposed to what you want to give them. So my suggestion is have a range based on, I mean, it's ridiculous that an apartment's going to be 200 feet less than a house.
I have a question for Chuck. I want to phrase it. Do we care if someone builds an entire complex of efficiencies?
I think it's all about bringing people to your community.
That's what I wanted to hear.
And, you know, the person who comes into your community at a young age potentially stays as their family grows and they buy a house, they do this and that. If they don't come in the first place, you're kind of limiting your options, because the reality is you want to have, you know, we have Chevrolets and Cadillacs. We got to have cheap apartments and expensive. For $900 a month in this community, you can rent a house.
Mm-hmm.
I got one I rent for $950, a whole house. So how am I going to rent an 800 square foot apartment for $1,200 a month?
Thank you, Mr. Schneider. Commissioner Helmut?
Are we getting rid of the regulation about the number of units in an apartment before it has to, it can't be a straight line and?
That's been removed.
Okay.
Commissioner Helmut, would you be willing to volunteer for a slight subcommittee duty?
I would live for that.
Mr. Corey, I would appreciate it if you and Commissioner Helmut would work briefly over the period between now and the next meeting and bring back to us a wording for this that seems to reflect many of the comments that have been made here tonight.
Okay.
Wow, I'm really sorry, everyone. Would you be willing to do that?
Absolutely. You do have a comment over here.
Yes, can I go over here?
If you please.
If you need to open lots, you're going to die.
I know. It's terrible. If you'd be kind enough to state your name, please, for the record.
My name is Gail Grix.
Welcome, Gail.
Thank you. In talking about unit size, I was late to the meeting. I apologize for that. There's a lot of turnover, and I can get you statistics mm-hmm. on it, on these small units. You get a transient population. In homes that are 1,000 square feet, I'm seeing a lot of young people living together. So if you've got a 1,300 square foot rent, you get three young men, you know, they're working on their engineering degree and they're renting it out for $400 a room, splitting utilities. That's what I see the demographic changing to. If, you know, it's kind of that thing, if you build it, they will come. Who are we building for? Who do we want in this community to, you know, to what serves the community's best needs? So, you know, in these smaller units, you will have a high turnover rate. I don't think that's good for a stable community. It's something that you want to consider. And again, there are statistics on that that can be, you know, brought into consideration. So it's just.
Gail, thank you for your comments. Would you be kind enough to state your address again for the record?
Certainly.
I didn't get that.
4151 Seymour Lake Road.
Outstanding. Thank you very much. I appreciate your comments. All right, so Chris, I think I'm going to close this out.
That's fine.
And I'm going to ask that you and Commissioner Helmut work together.
Absolutely.
To try to craft something. Obviously, this is an important consideration, so please give it your best effort. I know that you will.
Thank you.
And we'll look forward to hearing what you guys have to say about this next time we meet. Will that be acceptable?
It's a good idea.
Commissioner Helmut, thank you very Absolutely. Much for your sacrifice. I appreciate it.
Anything to get those kids out of my house.
There you go. That'll be good for all of us, I think.
They could all live together in a friend's house.
There you go. See?
They would just go.
They probably would love that.
It makes it more economical.
All right, then, finishing up new business, we can move on now to public comment. The floor is open for.
I do have a few more.
Oh, Chris, I'm sorry. Go right ahead.
If the commission wants to take them up tonight, in the other memo. The first one was the masonry screening wall.
Thank you very much.
Economic Development Subcommittee had recommended eliminating the masonry part and allowing other materials. And there are a few examples.
I see, thank you.
Three major developments that we've approved in the last couple of years is Emerge, Becker Eye Care, and the Weckel development. Developer pushed back on the masonry part every time. I think with Merge, we had a, well, you guys may be familiar with the faux stone wall along Pleasant Street there by the parking lot. And then for Weckel, it ended up being wood, and Becker, I believe, ended up being wood as well. Because we've had to negotiate on that, the Economic Development Subcommittee said having that as a hard and fast rule is something that is not looking tenable. On the other hand, the commission last meeting pointed out that it's not only an aesthetic, but a safety consideration, and masonry is much more effective than some of the other materials at providing the necessary screening. So the question before you guys is, do you want to keep that requirement or figure out some middle path?
Commissioner Curtis, I know that you spoke about this last time, and do you have anything to add to this?
It would be my suggestion that you keep the requirement. However, the wording at the discretion of the Planning Commission during the site plan review, there may be instances where it's high traffic. There may be instances where there's low traffic. So a good explanation is always listened to rather than the norm. You got to have it. But if the word's at the discretion, it could be talked away or it could be kept, my opinion.
By high traffic or low traffic, Jeff?
Take, for example, behind the Crittenden building.
Mm-hmm. Right on.
You have a changeover of about 100 cars a day coming in and out of that alley and parking lot. That would be a high traffic area. And if you had homes behind it with families in it, residential one, I don't know as if a wood fence would be as advantageous for health, safety, and welfare of the community and or noise as a wood fence would be.
I have a question on the subtle distinction here as far as wording goes. Would you prefer that this wording be that the Planning Commission can waive a masonry wall requirement that would otherwise apply? Or would you prefer that the Planning Commission can impose a masonry wall requirement in situations where there is a safety, noise, or other concern?
I have real concerns about any language to which this commission could be deemed to be granting favoritism to someone who's a local contractor versus someone who's out of town or someone who's related. I like black and white when it comes to things that we're going to allow or not allow. And I think the language that we have now, we've gone with wood. Our language must be okay. Not everybody has a brick wall. I think we should just leave it. It seems, it might be tedious, but it seems to be working for us.
We have a blank. There's language here that allows the Planning Commission to waive or alter any landscaping requirement as part of the site plan process. But, and I think that's probably how we said, all right, well, we can go ahead and change it. But is there a landscaping requirement? I don't know. I'd like to have a little more clarity. But I think that's the quote. Maureen phrases the question. Is this something that we want to say, no, you abut residential and you are non-residential, you must build a wall? Because that's basically what it currently says.
And we haven't always made it happen, so.
Mr. Schneider.
Well, I think from a developer standpoint, if you're building the Crittenden building and you're building a 20 or 30,000 square foot building and you got a lot of rental income, maybe you can afford a masonry wall. But for the average size project, that's probably a deal breaker because they're expensive. And I don't see any sound difference between a masonry wall and other products. I think the thing you should be adding to your ordinance is plastic fencing. I'm not really in favor of wood because wood is wood. You put it up, you paint it, 3 or 4 years, particularly if it's near your landscaping and the water gets on it.
That's been my concern as well.
And then the boards start warping.
Yep.
So
it just becomes a maintenance eyesore, unfortunately. It's one of the reasons why I'm not in favor of a wood wall, because the upkeep and maintenance on it is so profound.
You put plastic up, I mean, I've had some plastic fence up for 10 years. Other than getting algae on it that you got to hose off, it's like brand new. So you don't offer that option of plastic fencing. I mean, go to Home Depot. They got some very, very attractive plastic products, a lot of different colors,
sure,
and styles, and it's a very inexpensive alternative and gives you the same benefits of privacy and screening and so forth.
Chris, right now our zoning ordinance states that a masonry wall is required to screen properties.
It's one of the, I think it's either that or you build a berm. It's basically, there's an option.
A berm or a...
Or a masonry wall.
A masonry wall.
So the question is, can that wall be some other material and still be effective? Sounds like we have some disagreement on that, actually.
The guy doing glass B, he better get a lot of bricklayers, because he's got a lot of wall to build. He's going to screen all of the property.
You mean 98 Glaspie? He would have to screen it. A new commercial development would have to screen it. Residential, it doesn't go.
DPW yard, who's screening the DPW yard? Who's paying for that? Somebody has to pay for it. And I think, honestly, the developer makes.
But it doesn't have to be masonry, because the residential to commercial doesn't require a wall. Commercial to residential requires a wall, correct?
Well, that's the awkward question with these guys, because the non-residential use, that DPW yard, is already there and actually zoned residential. But there's no way you could have a house with a backyard right onto that DPW yard without some sort of screening. It does say between residential and C1 or C2 districts, you need a four to six foot high wall. And it says then masonry wall when you get into the details. Every single time, masonry wall. That wall goes up to 6 to 8 feet if you're next to industrial.
Use or zoning?
Zoning.
Well, the DPW garage is zoned residential.
Yeah, we'll get into that in the site plan, I suppose, but I think that one's a practical consideration, and that one is one where maybe we'd say, okay, it doesn't have to be masonry because technically you don't have to do it. From a practical standpoint, you should have something. But that's the exact sort of sideways reasoning that we've had to do in the past on this issue, which seems so simple, but because we had so much
pushback. Well, it's not, unfortunately. It's not simple at all, and not every circumstance is the same.
Yeah.
And so, you know, frankly, myself, as a commission, I would like to have more discretion in terms of what should be required and what's appropriate for each development. And the idea of, you know, the idea of making a development prohibitive because they're required to build a masonry wall when maybe something of a lesser nature would be adequate doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to me. I mean, that's, again, me saying that. I'd like to have more discretion, Chris. You know, if I were taking a stab at rewriting this, I'd like to have the commission have more discretion and to be able to accept options. You know, I mean, just because a developer comes to me with a site plan doesn't mean I have to accept it. And I can throw away any part of it that the commission doesn't like. And so, you know, I'd like to see us as a body have more discretion and be able to entertain more options. Commissioners, do you agree or disagree?
No, not everyone agrees. So I'm just wondering if this is something we should take a vote.
I agree. I'd like to have more discretion as to what we choose moving forward. My biggest concern with the block walls or brick walls is the industrialization of the downtown of the village.
Sure.
At the same time, the noise transmittance between the walls is inherently different. It might not be too audible, but there is going to be a particular difference. So in that regard, I do see the benefit of the brick wall, but But I think general, larger opportunity to decide would be advantageous for the committee.
Commissioner Helmuth?
I just really get concerned when we have too much discretion on the turn towards favoritism, and he's been here all of his life. He's a good guy. We're not going to make him build a wall, and we don't really like Chuck. Let's make him put up a really high wall. A big one.
12 foot high.
You know, I appreciate the idea of having some options, but they can go sideways.
And I can agree. I can see that opinion. I think that's also the reason of the council in itself. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, the majority would find the correct reasoning.
For what?
To make the decision.
Well, council wouldn't necessarily make a decision whether that's us who makes the decision or whether it has to be a wall. Wouldn't go to council.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Between us.
Oh.
Yes, I'm sorry.
That's okay. If you use the word council,
I use that.
To a different group of people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Commissioner Beba?
I'd like to see some discussion on that, but if it wasn't for the wall on Pearl Street and they wanted to put a berm there, there'd be a lot more cut-through traffic between the marketplace and Pearl Street. And that wall, I don't care what anybody says, I think that keeps out some of the noise from the neighbors that up against there, plus lighting.
Of course, and you can always use that example as a standard that you would apply to make sure that no favoritism. You know, I mean, Commissioner Helmuth, I certainly understand your concern, and I want you to know I hear it. But I'm just hard-pressed to believe this body's going to be favored for anybody. That's not the way we operate, I don't think. You know, I would like to think that we could apply our discretion to each and every case that faces us. Commissioner Bayman makes an excellent example. That's one where cinder block wall is absolutely required for a number of reasons.
No, but you just get the kids to stop from hopping it.
Sure, but there are some that I think that many times you could probably present an argument where a structure not that expensive would be just as effective. Chris, is this an issue that needs to be voted on, or can I just ask that you take this back and write me up a recommendation that includes more discretion? I think it seems to
if
be
that
the,
seems to be a sort of a at least
the will of a
sort of consensus.
The will of the consensus, if you don't mind.
I'll write something up with more.
Because we're not going to make a recommendation that the council take a look at these things yet, because we've got masonry wall screening, we've got multifamily densities that we still need to complete, so we're not ready to take action
exactly
on this tonight.
There'll be more information brought back for you to look at in terms of specific wording.
Thank you very much. Moving on to temporary outdoor sales.
Yes, this was asked last time in terms of, was specifically asked about fireworks. Temporary outdoor sales are currently, you can do them by special use in the C2 district under the current ordinance. The Economic Development Subcommittee recommendation was to go to to also allow them by special use in I-1, mainly because why not? and just a lot more flexibility there. They got rid of the bizarre requirement to go to the ZBA if you want to sell Christmas trees. And also the requirement about having only one display area in case you, for some reason, had to split. Just for flexibility. As far as fireworks go, we are required under current state law to treat fireworks the same as any other outdoor sales, if that plays into any decisions here. I'm not, I guess the question is, are you happy with this set of regulations? Now, we also have things in the current ordinance they didn't mention that have not been changed with regard to outdoor sales. Which are in 4.1.23, for anyone wants to look at them. The vast majority of them are still in play and should not, there's no recommendation to change them. So I guess the question is, is there still a concern here?
So the changes proposed to that section by the Economic Development Subcommittee were removing the restriction to only have one display area per business.
Yeah.
And a requirement for Christmas tree sales to be approved by the zoning board.
Yes. Those are the two things removed.
And again, explain the rationale for the zoning board being involved in that?
I have absolutely no idea.
What are they thinking?
I don't know. It says there's a specific subsection for Christmas tree sales, which makes sense. But it says, unless Christmas tree sales are accessory to a principal use of a site, a permit should be obtained from the Zoning Board of Appeals. And it does not mention any other sort of outdoor sale, just Christmas trees. So we don't have to get into that. Thank you. We don't have to get that into that too much detail. But yeah, it was. I don't understand why it was in there.
You can take that out for sure.
Well, don't all temporary uses have to go to the ZBA like the farmer's market did?
Maybe, but an outdoor businesses, other outdoor businesses were not
right
listed.
Temporary
events. But actually, I think in the draft we have, that's changed too. I have to find it.
To Joe's question, currently temporary outdoor sales are permitted by special use approval in C2.
Yes.
They don't go to the Zoning Board of Appeals after they're granted a special use. Okay. I would propose that you would do the same for Christmas trees. If you're going to allow a special use to sell trees, I mean, why would you send them to the ZBA for crap's sake? I mean, come on. I would get that out of there for sure.
I have a tendency to agree, Chris. I don't understand the rationale for that at all. And I think we should just make this as difficult as we possibly can, don't you think? I rarely submit to, or succumb to sarcasm, but occasionally I just can't help myself.
Well, it's easy sometimes, isn't it?
Pardon me?
It's easy sometimes.
Sometimes it's just too easy. If you toss it up in the air, I just feel compelled to swing at it.
and secondly, the number of restrictions to have only one display area per business.
The recommendation is to remove that.
To remove that, right. If you have five businesses on a piece of property and you have an event for 2 weeks, why wouldn't you allow all five businesses to have outdoor sales?
That was the concern.
And I agree that we should take that out.
Yeah.
I mean, that's my consensus.
Okay.
The Christmas trees allow more than one business on the property to have a special use sale or whatever in the C2 district. Now, to allow a special land use in light industrial, are you going to sell fireworks at the Parker Building? Are you going to sell them at Trison Tool?
I don't think so.
Why would we address that situation? I mean, that'd be about your only industrial is Glaspie.
Yeah, I'm not gonna like fight you on keeping that.
No, I'm not looking.
Sort of an opening.
Fireworks at Parker Hanneman.
Opening it up.
The what?
Why wouldn't you sell fireworks at Parker Hanneman?
Well, I'd have to rebut back to the chief to see if it would be okay.
I mean, I just don't know why we wouldn't allow them in the industrial. We still have vacant property there. Somebody could rent a lot, sell fireworks, sell Christmas trees.
You don't allow any sales in industrial property. Why would you have special land use to have outdoor sales in industrial, bringing commercial traffic into the industrial area? That area is bordered by all residential. That's just a thought.
Good point.
I don't think it's bordered. Most of our industrial is not bordered by any residential on the frontage and has quite a bit of space between the residential and the industrial.
We can pick out words, but I'm just saying, you want to bring commercial traffic into light industrial, that's what you want to do by raising that restriction of industrial commercial sale.
Well, do we have a consensus on this? I'm not really bothered either way. The change was just to sort of loosen restrictions in a way that, well, it's not hurting anybody, but Curtis has just brought up the way it could by increasing traffic on Glaspie Street. Sales and industrial, do you want it or not?
What's the likelihood that Parker Hannifin is going to sell fireworks out of their parking lot?
I think it's highly unlikely.
I mean, they're going to sell fireworks out of
sale.
The marketplace. Oh, is it really? All right. They're going to use the marketplace lot because that's the highest traffic area, and that's traditionally where they've set up, and that's where they'll continue to set up, I would imagine. You know, you want to be on a main road. You know, I would certainly want to have some transient business like that set up on a main thoroughfare, so I have traffic volume.
I'll remove the special use in industrial.
All right, I appreciate that, Chris. I think we could probably get consensus for that, is my expectation. Then you're also going to strike the ZBA requirement for Christmas trees, is that correct?
Yes.
And you're going to go ahead and leave the wording about removing the restriction to only one display?
That would also be removed.
Okay, good. All right. If you bring that back to us, my expectation is we'll likely approve that. And then finally, item four, Chris?
This is a toughie. You may just want to, it depends how long you want to discuss this for. Pollyant Trail and Powell Street, between IMP Properties and Oxford Road. The zoning of that property is currently multiple family residential. The Economic Development Subcommittee suggested changing it to industrial to match IMP stamping, especially if they want to expand. On the other hand, especially when you're over on Powell Street, there's residential exactly immediately across the street. On the other hand, it's the largest piece of vacant land in the village. So the question is, what do we want to zone it? And do we want to do something creative, which, for instance, Rochester has done, and create a flex zoning category? A category in which, say, every use listed is a special use or something like that, so that a developer could say, I see a use for this property and here's what it is, and they come in and ask for that use for your approval. Some concept like that that I would have to flesh out. So given those three choices, well, I guess you could have a fourth choice. You could go to single family residential too, if we think that's more appropriate. But zoning that land, the master plan set calls for multiple family residential, but it does so more out of inertia than anything else. It's just that land has been discussed a lot. So I guess this question before the committee is, what kind of development do we think we can attract to that land, and therefore what do we want to zone it?
One thing to consider is the north side, which is the township, and we have industrial use. And we have a large storage area.
Yep, that's all zoned L1 or I1.
Mm-hmm. You know, looking at what could work there is uncertain, and you know, this proposal for the special projects makes the best sense, because
that's what
somebody
I'm thinking.
Might come forth with an idea, sure, compromise, and give us an opportunity at least to get some interest to say, here's what we...
Just a second.
You could propose and we could see
if it works. Of course. Go ahead, Commissioner Curtis.
You know, I wrestle with this. As soon as you say I-1, you know, Mo brought this up last time, you're putting industrial next to residential. I agree. You know, it's a hard fact. I-1 includes anything up to a tire manufacturer, to a heavy stamping plant. But the kind of industries that we're having around here tends more to what Chris is offering with a flex zoning, if you will. You have no industrial properties here in the town that are for rent. Parker has two offers currently on that building right now, and they're fighting at over sticker price for it, zoned I-1. Rooftops versus industrial in your community, you're bearing all the load of the infrastructure on the residents. It's good to have a healthy mix of industrial properties, but is the term industrial what you really want? You want a cashmere tool coming here saying, I want 25,000 square feet where I'm going to put in 5-axis head milling machines that by OSHA standards you don't even have to wear ear protection for anymore. You know, that's a more modern research type industry. It gives it that industry name. It's not a giant 3,000 ton stamping press pounding out frames every day. Mm-hmm. You want to be able to pay some of these millage debts by
you know, industry.
Attracting industry, sure.
And you don't have any in this community. More and more are being taken away as they're developed by, like, 98 Glasby Street and some of the others. Where's the proper mix? I-1 is a dinosaur terminology in today's technology. You don't want I-1. You know, you really don't. You want something a little less, but you want to be able to have a modern assembly facility. You heard the guy from IMP come in here. They've reduced decibels on those stamping presses by 40 dB by going to the new processes. These machines are so much more quiet. A flexible zoning may allow you to have technology in there. Industrial zoning allows you to open the door. Yeah. So, okay, I agree to a point. You don't want industrial, but you do want to have the availability to allow a modern technology to come in that's not intrusive into the community, that's going to pay some of these taxes.
That's Mr. Corey, we don't have a special project.
No, we'd be creating a zoning district.
We would be creating a zoning district in order to do so.
Yeah, although what Mr. Curtis suggested sounds like a research and development type zoning district, where we could basically take what our I-1 district is, but roll back some of the really intrusive type of industrial uses that we allow in that, and say, we're looking more at a high tech industry or even an office space type thing. So it's not residential, but it's a little bit. That's something I think we could craft too.
Wouldn't the special projects give us that flexibility?
But it would also allow a potential residential. I think the big thing about a special projects district that. It's not like a reason not to do it, but it's a concern that we'd have to look at is, what if someone only wants part of the district? And they say, well, I have this great idea, high-tech business, we'd enter off Oxford Road or something, and we're going to be part of the township, and it's really cool. But then, like, someone, so they're on the far eastern side, and then the western side, closer to IMP, but then also in front of single-family homes, well, someone says, well, I want to do multiple family there. Well, now we would allow that. We'd have to have some sort of way that the special projects district, like, almost closes itself and becomes whatever the first thing that goes in. The special projects reflects that somehow. I'd have to look at what Rochester does,
mm-hmm.
And how they make this work. But so there's some complexity to it. But certainly something. If that's how you want to pursue, I can bring you some ideas and we can go from there.
Again, you know, I'm all about discretion, and I.
Yeah. Well, I just was going to say, you know, I don't like the I-1 because it's a dinosaur terminology. You're putting this big pounding piece of equipment in there all day long. That's not what you want. But you want a UPS truck pulling up, picking up a $35,000 jig for an F-35 fighter from a machine that you can't even hear. Where can a conditional zoning be implied in this district? Say, I don't know if you'd call it research development, light manufacturing, but call it conditional zoning only. Can you do that into a district?
And that's an interesting idea. So basically, the way this district operates is, if you want to go here, propose a conditional rezoning.
Right.
And we are, the village is.
Then you control your trees, your buffering, your parking, your everything.
But it's also because the way conditional rezonings work, the developer's suggestion.
Yes.
So.
No, it's just
basically
commitment.
What we're saying is, this land is almost basically unzoned, and. We want your suggestion as to what you want to build there and how you think the zoning should work, and we will give you a yes or no answer.
And then you still have the discretion of saying, no, we don't want a tire manufacturer there. We don't want a frame stretcher. And
I would like to raise one concern. Sorry for interrupting.
Please, Mr. Johnson.
You know, I agree with the I-1 being inappropriate for the area. My second concern is the increased traffic throughout the residential areas due to deliveries, pickups, drop-offs, whatnot. It is already a primary concern of the residents of the community, the increased commercial traffic within the residential streets. And so that'd be a concern of mine. And without having an appropriate avenue to get out to M24, other than residential, or I guess the road in front of the high school as well. That would be a concern. Just a thought.
All right, thank you.
Access is a concern.
Yes.
Joe, I forget. Does the Pollyann Trail run directly next to?
Yes.
Powell Street? There's no?
Yes.
There's about a 20-foot buffer.
Yeah.
But it's all right away.
Powell, 20-foot.
Okay, so it doesn't Pollyann. Run right up next to it?
There's a 20-foot buffer.
So you're looking for someone to develop 20 feet of property?
No.
Then not use 20 feet of property, then use the balance?
Mm-mm.
Chief?
There's also the Edison high tension wires that run down there, so you got another easement of at least 50 or more north of that also. Because you can't build on that easement.
What would be very helpful to answer Maureen's question is the map that shows Powell Street.
Sure.
20-foot unbuildable buffer area, Pollyann Trail, 50-foot easement.
See, I thought that
you're 100
there.
Feet
exactly.
from the houses.
And the property's not that big.
Right.
No.
Now you're up into the 13.5 acres north of that.
That's not even in the village.
No, there is part of that is in the village. Then you go into the I-1 that's out of the village.
I mean, I think the special projects is a very interesting thing, and I'd like to see more on it. But I need to see a map of this
yeah.
property. Because it's also, I think it's just two parcels that's also split in the center by what would be a continuation of Division Street. I just don't remember.
Yeah. I think it may be split north and south, too.
We don't have one.
What it is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I do too.
Google Maps.
Yeah, I'll bring a.
Chris, if you'd be so kind.
An 11x17 aerial photo and with some annotations.
I think you've also sort of got the feel of the commission
yep,
and hopefully a consensus. I'm hoping you can look at what Rochester's done and perhaps.
All Street.
Seems like we want to pursue special projects district. Basically, kind of go along the idea of conditional
right.
rezoning district,
right.
basically.
Right.
Those houses on the south of Powell.
They're going to appreciate that.
70 some feet before the property line of that property.
Well, that's what I want to see.
Yeah.
All right. Chris, would that complete your report on the zoning amendment discussion items?
Yes, it would, and I have my instructions for next time.
Good, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. All right. We have our consultant comments completed. All right, so we're looking at that. We need public, okay, item number 10 then, is that correct, Mr. Secretary? Public comment, any of the remaining members, if they have public comment, please step up and I'm willing to hear whatever you have to say.
Not you, Mark.
We're dumb kids.
She's kidding, Mark, I hope. And Mark, once again, if you'd be kind enough to state your name and address for the record.
Okay, I'm Mark Miner from 50 Pearl Street.
Thank you.
I got two items I want to talk about briefly. One is on Edison Alley, which was put up recently. And in that development, there was re-landscaping of the area where a big berm was put in there and a series of trees and or shrubs and, well, not in there. My question is, the life expectancy of those plants, is there a guarantee of how long they're supposed to be, or there will always be, if one dies, a replacement put in there? That's one of my questions. Because as I've seen on berms before, they don't always make it. And so now you got a barren desert there, which once was taking time to put all those plants in there. So, I personally live right across from the bank, but on the other side of Pearl Street, so we see it pretty good. And I'm really disappointed that the big trees got knocked out of there and put in those little stubby things. There's no equivalent to what we have, and I think we got shortchanged on that. But what even would be worse if what we had there now is gone and you've got nothing. So I would propose, the power of one, that we put some more trees in there and or arborvitaes or something that will grow in time that make a vegetative wall that gives a little more privacy from all that light and stuff from that side there. So I make a motion. I don't know if I can even do that. But that's one of my requests. And the other question I have is, what is the distance required from your property line to an outbuilding?
I can get that number for you.
Is that 2 feet or 3 feet or?
For residential?
Yes. The reason why I ask that question is because we have a neighbor who has a shed that's probably at 6 inches from our property line. And I don't think that's to code.
No, it's, are they to your side? Or to
right behind our property?
Rear. Behind you. It's 3 feet from the back property line, 5 feet from the side property line.
But that's a permanent structure.
That is, yes.
If the shed's not on a foundation, it's not a permanent structure.
Okay.
And it's quite possible that it's legal, I believe.
What's the
that we have to, that we have to look into exactly how it's constructed, but
it's a shed.
It's on a building.
Mm-hmm.
A slab.
Yeah.
Building. We define a building as, and this is, it says accessory buildings must be 5 feet from the property line. So, building is any structure, either temporary or permanent, having a roof or other covering, and used or built for the shelter or enclosure of, and there's a long list of stuff. A building shall include tents, awnings, carports, semi-trailers, vehicles, mobile homes, pre-manufactured, pre-cut structures, designed primarily for shelter rather than a means of conveyance. So actually, yeah. Maureen, I disagree with
Mr.
you.
Mr. Meyer?
You might be very right. We'd have to look at it.
I would like to encourage you to get a hold of the gentleman here on my left, our village manager, and I'm sure he can bring the proper authorities to bear on an evaluation of this, and if it needs resolution, I'm sure that'll happen.
Okay, I would appreciate that, sure.
Of course.
And the other thing is that we had a wall. I built a 6-foot wooden fence before all that big development came in, and they built all those homes. And the neighbor had built up his dirt against the wood fence, which is now teetering towards my property line. I don't know if there's any recompense on that or not, but it just don't seem right. So I don't know if I have any kind of legal rights on that or if you just, it's sour grapes, but.
And again, I think this is a topic for Mr. Young.
Okay.
And I know that he will be happy to assist you with that
okay.
as well.
I appreciate that. Thanks.
Yes, thank you okay. very much. All right, still in public comments. Any other comments?
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Young. If you'd be kind enough, state your name and address for the record, please.
Once again, Richard Schroeder from 72 Pearl Street.
Thank you, Richard.
And I believe this is probably also going to fall in Joe's area of expertise.
It's what he does.
I was wondering about who actually does maintain the Scripter Trail. And in conjunction with that, who enforces, if there are any type of regulations on foliage on alongside of sidewalks? I've been spending time rehabbing knee surgeries and all that, walking the village quite a bit. And there's some areas, mature and even newer, where the foliage, somebody may have some shrubs along the sidewalk, it kind of goes over the sidewalk, you end up having to go off into the street or walk the median. Even along Gillespie Street on the development, they put in some shrubbery between the sidewalk and the street. And sometimes when spring comes, the branches get heavy, you have to step off. I'm now gonna try and evolve to riding bicycles again. And there's some roads in the village I just assume not be on the street.
I understand.
The parked cars and all that.
Yep.
So I'm just wondering if that's under the jurisdiction. Does the village actually monitor that? They take
We do.
Recommendations
we
if
do.
Somebody notices that there's obstructions.
And Richard, if you walk down here and take Joe's card, he'll be more than happy to provide assistance
I'll
to you in this regard.
Personal time during the conference.
There you go.
Get a balloon and
go
ask
for
a question.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Any other public comment? All right. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Chris, we come to you for our consultant comments.
I have nothing further tonight.
All right, thank you very much. We move on to item 12, which is commissioner comments. Ladies and gentlemen of the commission, starting with Commissioner Helmuth, do you have anything that you would like to state tonight?
We have an opening on the planning commission, if anyone's interested.
Mm-hmm.
Get to make decisions up here, Callie.
There you go. That's what everybody's looking at you. Everybody's
over
looking
to the
at
dark
you.
Side, Callie.
It's actually it's a great deal of fun, and we really have a good time doing this. All right, good. We'd love to have you.
Take men too.
Yeah.
I have nothing
Mark
else.
Would be. All right, Commissioner Bama.
None.
Commissioner Curtis?
I can do both mine at the same time here.
Thank you very much.
Starting Thursday night, February 23rd, the Township Planning Commission will be reviewing the master plan, setting up the surveys, setting up public input times and places. So feel free to attend with your comments and concerns, any direction you'd like to go from there on. The next one is threefold, and it all surrounds Lakeville Road. Lakeville Road will be resurfaced from Glasby Street to Rochester Road this year, 2017. Wow. And within that time frame, you have your school that runs until June 16th, buses, cars, vehicles. You have a 10,000 person event going on June 3rd and 4th, which is the Tough Mudder at Koenig Gravel Pit. You also have the Lakeville water main that the township is running from Willow Lake Sub to Lakeville Mobile Home Park. So there's a lot of activity this summer on Lakeville Road. The water main will be going across the school property, so we won't be doing that until June 16th. But the contractor is going to be approved this week's business, but they may start as early as May from Willow Lake to the school. So bear witness, that road's going to be screwed up this whole summer. To that, just for public information, the water main hookup, Sue, I don't know if you're aware of, the township is going to be hooking up two emergency water main hookups, not to loop your system, but to prevent the system in an emergency from cutting off your residence and cutting off our residence should a water main break. So we are installing two emergency hookups and paying for them, and your attorney is drafting the paperwork for the when's you turn them on, turn them off, flush them, and all the minutia.
I believe we still have to say yes to that.
Well, you can if you'd like to, but I can guarantee it's going to happen. So
I can guarantee it's not going to happen unless the council approves it.
I can guarantee you it's going to happen. But that's some pretty good news, but it's going to be busy on Lakeville Road.
Have they determined any detour routes or anything for when this is all happening?
There's no other paved routes.
So no. there's really no need for detour other than the detour when they're milling. They'll shut a lane down.
Okay.
If there's most of the work on the water main outside of the road right away is going to be open cut, but under the road is going to be bored, so you won't be closing the road down for a ditch operation. Any questions? That's all I have.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Curtis. Commissioner Johnson.
Just to like to give everybody a quick little update regarding the wayfinding signage for the parking. Chris provided us a quote. We've discussed the quote. Prices are a little high. We're going to continue to discuss with Chris to see what we can do to bring those down, but we are in making some progress, so I'll keep you updated.
Have you been able to acquire a budget on this?
I do not have a budget as of yet, so that'd be great to find out.
Mm-hmm. It would be nice to know sort of what the council would be leaning towards.
Yes.
So that you're not you know, because I appreciate the fact that you say that this is high, but in reality, it may not be high at all. I mean, without an idea of what you have available to spend.
That is true.
You know, it would be not, you know, I mean, talk to Sue and say, you know, this is what we're looking at.
I'd rather not blow it out of the water, but I appreciate the...
And I certainly appreciate your willingness to try to, you know, watch the spending that we do, which is, you know, pretty minimal, if you don't mind my saying so. But, you know, I would also like these to be appropriate, nice signs.
Yep.
You know, it's the idea we're considering is that much of the parking in the village is off the main street. And so, unfortunately, people who pass through don't know the parking is there. And so they see the main street is crowded and there's no parking available, so they just keep right on going. And they head down to Lake Orion and they go shopping there, where we want people to consider the fact that shopping in Lake Orion is a good experience and that we have parking right off the main street. And so we would consider having designs designed and built for us that we could put on the main street, say, parking's right over here, and that would be going both ways, hoping to attract more shoppers to the people who have businesses along the way. So that's it. We think that's a good thing and a worthy cause, and we're investigating that right now, and Adam has charge of that subcommittee. All right, thank you very much, Adam. I appreciate that. We heard from Jack for the Oxford Township Planning Commission update, so thank you very much for that, Commissioner Curtis. We have a ZB update now from our new ZBA correspondent, Commissioner Bama, so if you have a report, I'd love to hear it.
The ZBA has not met.
I understand that. I know it happens infrequently sometimes.
And it hasn't met for a while.
All right, well, just keep us in mind, and when you do meet, I'm sure you'll have something to tell us.
At some point, I'll have something to tell you.
All right. At that point now, we conclude our meeting. I want to say two things. Our next regularly scheduled meeting, the Planning Commission, will be on March 7th. We typically meet twice a month, on the first Tuesday and on the third Tuesday at 7 p.m. in these chambers. You're always welcome. Like I said, next meeting is March 7th. Following that will be the 21st. At this point, I would accept a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Secretary, I have a motion from Commissioner Curtis and a second from Commissioner Bama. All those in favor of adjourning our meeting this evening signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
I'm opposed.
Good. No, you're not. Ladies and gentlemen, meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much for attending.
I wasn't aware this long.